So recently we did a video on showing why 9.999 going on forever is equal to 10. And afterwards we got a request from someone in Korea actually to do something related, which we're going to do today. And I found a really, really nice movie clip that kind of introduces it. So let's just watch that first.
A negative times a negative equals a positive. A negative times a negative equals a positive. Say it. A negative times a negative equals a positive. Say it.
A negative times a negative equals a positive.
Again.
A negative times a negative equals a positive. A negative times a negative equals a positive.
I can't hear you.
A negative times a negative equals a positive.
Louder. A negative times a negative equals a positive. Louder.
A negative times a negative equals a positive.
Well, first of all, I mean, what's the movie here? What's the movie? Very famous movie. May not be familiar with it, but famous among teachers, especially. Stand and Deliver. You may be familiar with the actor, he's the same actor who played Commander Adama on Battlestar Galactica. Anyway, if you haven't seen the movie, check it out. Stand and Deliver. Great, great movie. Great clip. So the question is, why is negative times negative positive? And, well, you might ask, well, what else can it be? Well, the only reason why you ask what else can it be is because you've been indoctrinated to believing that, negative times negative is positive. So it's actually a bit tricky when you kind of first encounter it. You may have forgotten, but when you first encounter it, it's quite tricky. So let's just remind ourselves of what the issue really is. Okay, and for that, we'll try and put ourselves into the shoes of some ancient civilization. So if they've just kind of introduced numbers, so maybe they've got all the positive numbers under control, they have got zero, and now they've just lost their innocence. They've introduced money, and now there's people, you know, owing money to other people, so there's people in debt. And so to describe this, they've made up negative numbers, okay? And well, now you just have to kind of combine these positive numbers and the negative numbers, and well, some of the things are kind of under control, so let's just see where we've got so far. We've got things like 3 plus 4, obviously 7. Then somebody might be 3 in debt, and now he gets 4, and so that leaves him with 1. What about 3 in debt, and then he goes further, 4 in debt into debt, and so that is 7 debt, but now times. So what is that supposed to mean? A negative number times a negative number, a negative number times a negative number. So what do we do with this? Bit tricky, so let's just step up back a bit. So minus 3 times 4. Well, that's something we can handle. So basically, whenever we see something like this, usually the way we interpret it is like 3 times 4 is we take 3 and then we do 3 plus 3 plus 3 plus 3, so 4 times. And that gives 12. So we can do the same stuff here with minus 3. So it's minus 3 plus minus 3 plus minus 3 plus minus 3. It's minus 12. Okay, good. All under control. What about this one here? That's already a little bit tricky, right? 3 times minus 4. What's that supposed to mean, right? So we've got 3, and then we're supposed to do this minus 4 times. Well, whatever, right? So at this point in time, and that's actually a really, really good approach in mathematics and just in general, is we're just going to do it. We're just going to do it. Nike approach, right? That's the t-shirt today. We're just going to do it. We're just going to see, well, we know all this stuff about the positive numbers, how to behave, right? We know all the rules. And we want those rules to still all work when we're finished with introducing, you know, all those extra bits about the negative numbers. So we're just going to think positive, and we think, well, maybe it's going to work out. And if it's going to work out, so what's going to happen? Well, first thing is, with positive numbers, we know that if we've got two positive numbers, like 3 and 4, we can also switch the order, and then, you know, the result is the same. So in this case, if things are good in the end, we should be able to just switch the two numbers around, and we got minus 4 times 3, and we already know that's minus 12. All under control. Now, back to this one here. And again, we just kind of continue with our just do it approach, right? So we want things to kind of hang together in exactly the same way as we're used to. So, okay, so for starters, we don't know what that is, okay? So let's just take the times minus 4 away, store it away there. And now what we're going to do is we're going to turn the minus 3 into something familiar, into something positive. Okay, what we're going to do is this, is we're going to just add 3. Okay, so we're going to add 3. And what comes out? 0. Okay? So, well, we haven't turned it into something positive, but we have turned it into something that we can control, a 0 and a 3. We know how to multiply those two numbers with minus negative numbers, right? And so what we're going to do now is we're going to just go on autopilot. So we're multiplying that whole equation by minus 4, all right? So let's get going. 0 times minus 4 is?
0.
Perfect. Okay, 3 times minus 4 is?
12.
Very good. All right, we are on track. Then minus 3 times minus 4, we still don't know, but we can just put it in now, okay? So we put it in, and now we've got an equation, and there's basically one unknown, right? One thing we don't know, and two things we do know, and we can just solve things now for the unknown, basically, or other way, we add 12 to both sides of the equation, okay? And that gives us minus 3 times minus 4 is equal to 12. And so it's basically forced on us, right? So if we want things to work the way they used to work with just positive numbers, we don't have a choice here. We have to say that minus 3 times minus 4 is equal to 12. Okay. So I mean that's just our just do it approach. But of course now comes the checking period. So how are we going to check that all this kind of makes sense? Well, we can check it as mathematicians. You know, as mathematicians, we can now go and say, well, with the way we've introduced multiplication of negative numbers by negative numbers, is everything kind of consistent? Are we going to get any, you know, things that go wrong? Can we get contradictions, stuff like this? And we've checked, and everything's fine. So that's good. But then, of course, also the other thing we want to know is that, you know, do these things actually work in real life now, right? So if we have something in real life, and it kind of matches in with negative numbers, is this going to give us the right result? That would be good, right? Well, we could just be lazy and, you know, unleash it on humanity and, you know, wait a couple of hundred years, see whether anything goes wrong. Well, we kind of have done this and nothing did go wrong, so we can probably, okay, it's okay. It's okay, right? But let me just give you an example of the first bit, that things can't go wrong within mathematics. And I've got a really, really nice application for this. And I do this quite often when I go to schools. So when I go to schools, I've got different routines. So I may talk about the mathematics of juggling. So I talk about, you know, I juggle a little bit and then I talk about the maths of it. But I've also got one routine where I'm a lightning calculator. So a person who can calculate really, really quickly just using his mind, right? And so I would maybe ask you for your date of birth and I immediately tell you on which day you're born, or I square numbers, okay? So I ask you to give me a number and I square it quickly. And so I just want to show you what I do there. So say, you say square 48, okay? Then the way I do it for this particular routine is I rewrite 48 as 40 plus 8, okay? And then I use this rule, a plus b squared is equal to a squared plus 2ab plus b squared. Okay, and of course here, what's a? A is 40 and b is 8. So let's just do it, right? So we need a squared, which is 40 squared. It's 4 times 4 is 16. Then we need two zeros, 1,600. Cool. Then we need 2 times 4 times 8. So 2 times 4 times 8, that's 8 times 8. 64 and another 0, so it's 640, okay? And then the last one is b squared, so the b is the 8, so 8 squared is another 64, okay? And quickly add it up, and you get 2,304. Very quick. I mean, that doesn't even take a, half a second. It's just there. All right, but to be honest, I actually don't do this one here. I do something different. I mean, if the 8 was a 2, I would do it like this. But since it's 8, and it's this number is actually pretty close to 50, what I actually really do is I use 50 minus 2. And I use the same rule. Now 50 minus 2 is 50 plus minus 2. So the b is now a minus 2. So in the end, we're actually going to do minus 2 times minus 2. So let's just see whether we get the same result, right? So 50 squared is 2,500. Then we need 2 times 50 times minus 2, which is minus 200. And now comes the tricky one, right? Minus 2 times minus 2 is 4, right? Nothing else is 4, so we have to actually add 4. And you can see at a glance, we get the same result. All is good. And just in general, no matter what kind of acrobatics you try to do to get into something that doesn't work, like one which works one way and doesn't work the other way, you're never going to get into any trouble if you introduce negative numbers like this. So that's really, really good. Right? Okay, but in real life, does this thing actually come up in real life, minus 2 times minus 2? Well, actually, to be absolutely honest, most people will be able to lead a perfectly fine life without ever using this, without ever using this rule. And it's actually been, historically, it's been a fairly late development, and there's actually been lots of fights over it, whether it should be like this or some other way. So it's a fairly late thing that this minus negative times negative equals positive actually made an appearance and became accepted. But there are actually instances in real life where you can have an interpretation of all this stuff, which kind of makes sense and kind of fits in with what we've introduced. So let's just give one example here. So we're multiplying two numbers, okay? So there's the first number, there's the second number. The first number we're going to interpret as credit, like money, right? Credit if it's a positive number, and as debt if it's a negative number, okay? The second number we're going to interpret as gaining something. So here we're gaining something 4 times, or losing something 4 times if it's a negative number, okay? And then this is all kind of combinations of positives with negatives. So 3 credit, and we have this 4 times, then of course we've got 12 credit, okay? Or 3 credit, when we lose 3 credit 4 times, well, then we have a debt of 12, okay? Or if we've got a debt of 3, and we do this 4 times, we so basically gain a debt 4 times, then we're also at minus 12, so we've got a debt of 12. And what about a debt of 3, and we lose the debt? So losing the debt means gaining, right? So we lose a debt of 3 4 times, and that means we've got a credit of 12. Makes sense, right? So it fits in. And whatever else you can kind of think up in real life also makes sense. Okay, so it's all good, right?
Why?
So why? Why? Well, because if we introduce it like this, it's the only way in which we can get really, really nice mathematics happening, which extends all the nice things we're used to from the positive numbers. But also, it works. It works. And I mean, we've been trialing it for a couple of hundred years. It really works. That's really good. Now, just an afterthought. Within mathematics, there's actually there's a few places where you're actually dealing with screwed up multiplications. And just for my personal history, there was an instance when I actually was getting into research where it was getting very important to define minus 2 times minus 2 is plus 8. Well, maybe I'll tell you about that one in another video.